Is dairy your friend or foe? On one hand, dairy can contain all the nutrients our bodies need to thrive. On the other hand, dairy can cause massive amounts of inflammation on its own due to modern conditions and if you're allergic to it. Dairy is not only nutritionally complete, it is delicious, very palatable, and a super approachable food. It's much easier and practical to get someone to drink a glass of milk, have some cheese, cream, or butter, as opposed to eating nose to tail, all parts of the animal. In the context of obtaining complete nutrition from animal foods, dairy is arguably the easiest and most enjoyable way to do so. But if you are allergic to dairy or due to modern processing methods, dairy goes from the holy grail of nutrition and sustenance to something not so good for us. I have personally had a love-hate relationship with dairy. As delicious as raw grass-fed dairy is, I am allergic to it and don't really tolerate it too well. That being said, in my 7 years of being on a carnivorous diet, I have experimented on and off massively with dairy. So there are three main categories: raw, grass-fed, ideally what we should consume; pasteurized, grass-fed, that should really only be consumed if it's your only source of fat; pasteurized, homogenized, grain-fed, which is most supermarket dairy, which really shouldn't be consumed unless you had to. This is rancid and oxidized. It's been sitting on the shelf. Same with any pasteurized dairy. Pasteurization is when they heat the dairy to a certain temperature for a certain length of time to kill bacteria. Not only does this kill the beneficial bacteria present in the food, this lowers the nutrient content, and now we have a food that's lower in nutrients, it's missing the beneficial bacteria, and it doesn't digest as well because raw foods are digested better by the body, and raw foods also contain enzymes that aid in digestion. Not only do the enzymes in the food aid in digestion, the body digests raw food using its own enzymes much easier. The homogenization process is when they essentially shrink the fat particles of the milk. This is so that the cream doesn't separate and go to the top of the milk. They put it under very high pressure, the fat globules shrink, and as you can imagine, smaller fat globules can leak through the intestinal lining easier. So by pasteurizing and homogenizing the raw grass-fed dairy, we go from something that's good for us to literally harmful. And, you know, there's theories around this that pasteurizing and homogenizing dairy isn't for our health and for bacterial concerns. It's literally so we don't get healthy, as you can imagine. A lot of people would lose money if everyone was drinking half a gallon of raw grass-fed milk a day. Not only would everyone get healthy and not have to go to doctors and spend all this money, they wouldn't be buying the crappy food anymore. So, you know, in ideal circumstances, you only consume raw grass-fed dairy. If you don't have access to raw grass-fed dairy, then you can find other sources of animal sustenance that are of high quality. The main thing to understand here, guys, is that raw dairy is not the Wild West. All batches of raw dairy have to be tested for certain bacteria. There are very strict regulations around it that people don't seem aware of. People are generally very concerned about bacteria in dairy that's not heated or pasteurized, but it is always tested. And the issue here isn't that raw dairy inherently has bacteria in it. It's from cross-contamination. If anything, your risk of getting sick buying food from the supermarket is just as high as consuming raw dairy. This is one of those fear-mongering tactics that try to steer people away from nutritious, healthy foods. One interesting thing is the variance in nutrition in breast milk and correspondingly cow's milk. Human breast milk can go from 0.04% to 1.6% in DHA, depending on the fish content of the mother's diet. And although cow's milk doesn't contain EPA or DHA, it contains conjugated linoleic acid and alpha-linolenic acid. This is just to show the variance and how much of a difference the quality of food the mammal is eating goes directly into their breast milk. This also kind of ties into why grass-fed dairy always tastes better. and it's because it is fad-based. You don't really hear people saying, oh, I like supermarket dairy better than Kerrygold. Everyone seems to be in love with Kerrygold butter, which is a very popular grass-fed butter brand. But a good analogy to make here is chocolate milk. The reason that some people prefer grain-fed steak to grass-fed steak is because they're covering up the flavor of the grain feeding by cooking the steak and salting it. Imagine if you took some regular supermarket grain-fed dairy and you put some chocolate syrup and sugar in it, and then you said, oh, this tastes better than the raw milk. Like, yeah, because you added chocolate syrup and sugar in it. I have a video comparing grain-fed to grass-fed dairy last week, as well as meat several weeks ago. So definitely check that out if you want to see the difference in flavor, color, look, all of those things. But this pasteurized, homogenized grain-fed dairy is rancid, it's oxidized, it lacks nutrition, it causes stress in the body. Under no circumstance should you be consuming conventional dairy for the most part, especially pasteurized grass-fed. If you did only have access to these two things, then maybe you could argue that as your sole source of fat, something like clarified butter or ghee, where you remove the milk proteins in the butter, might be a temporary option. So just to summarize, raw grass-fed dairy is higher in nutrients, it has beneficial bacteria, and raw dairy digests better because of enzymes in both the dairy and our bodies digesting it easier. Now, here are some nutrient estimates that I accumulated from a variety of sources. This is for 4 cups of milk. I figured that was a pretty good amount, you know, if someone did drink raw dairy or consume raw dairy in their diet. 4 cups seems to be accurate, corresponding to, you know, an amount of dairy, butter, cream, cheese, or anything that people would consume. And these nutritional estimates apply universally to quality dairy products. So, granted, the dairy was on pasture and getting the vitamins and minerals, elements, fatty acids from the grass, this is the thing, guys. These grain-fed cattle aren't getting the nutrients they need from the grass. Their diet is devoid of nutrition, so their milk is not nutritious. All of these vitamins and minerals and elements are dependent on the pasture quality. The variance is huge. And it could even be the difference between cows eating hay in the winter and fresh green grass in the summer. There's a reason cows are so happy in the summer when the grass is growing. They call it the spring dance when cows see grass for the first time, because that is where they get their nutrition and that is where they really thrive. So if you have the grass, you have this nutrition. That is what we are assuming here. Now, this nutrition applies universally to every single dairy product, whether it's milk, cream, butter, cheese, kefir, you name it. If it was a high quality milk product, it will have nutrition. The difference is the fat versus the protein profile. Something like butter or cream that is more fat-based with less protein will have more fat-soluble vitamins and less water-soluble vitamins, whereas a protein-based food like milk will have higher amounts of B12 and vitamin C. That's the main difference. Both cheese and milk, for instance, are nutritionally complete. It's just two slightly different forms, and depending on the bacterial culture, the nutritional profile can change slightly. But the main point here is, you know, these vitamins are in their animal form. When people look at the RDAs of animal foods, they're like, oh, it only has 30% of your vitamin A and kale has like 3,000%. Yes, but the form of the vitamin in kale isn't getting absorbed by your body. So tough luck, buddy. This animal food arguably has the highest amounts of the animal forms of vitamins consistently across the board. So we have all the fat-soluble vitamins, we have all the water-soluble vitamins, we have a lot of minerals, elements, fatty acids. We have every single thing our body needs to thrive. You could literally only consume milk pretty much, I would say, indefinitely and be fairly healthy. So we have the animal form of vitamin A, retinol. We have B12, which only occurs in animal foods. We have vitamin C in a fairly high amount. The vitamin C RDA is way too high, but I've spoken about that in other videos. Vitamin D, 10%. We're meant to really obtain vitamin D from the sun, but it is interesting that when cows are on pasture in the sun, their milk does contain vitamin D. There is no RDA for vitamin E, but people ask all the time, oh, where are your antioxidants on a carnivore diet? Any quality animal food that contains fat will contain antioxidants, vitamin C, and vitamin E. Vitamin K, this is in the form of K2, which is much more important for the human skeletal system, as well as organs for calcium metabolism. Sodium, potassium, calcium, magnesium, all the electrolytes in fairly high amounts. The calcium is very high. Again, the calcium RDA, just as the vitamin C RDA, is way too high. The calcium RDA is essentially covering up a vitamin K2 and D3 deficiency in the United States. I've spoken about that in my calcium video, but despite being high in calcium, what I'm saying is we don't really need this much calcium. Magnesium, it's important to note, guys, these minerals are not bound to negative substances as they are in plant foods. Minerals are chelated. What we mean by chelated is they are bound to another molecule. In the case of magnesium or calcium in a plant food, they might be bound to an oxalic acid molecule, oxalates, and that binds to them, takes them out of the body, stores them in places they're not supposed to be. In animal foods, magnesium and calcium are not bound to these oxalates. So since there is no presence of oxalic acid, the availability of these minerals is substantially higher. So you might say, oh, well, milk has 130 milligrams of magnesium. I can get that in one Brazil nut. It doesn't make any sense because you're only absorbing a small percentage of the minerals from plant foods, if any at all. Great source of iron, iodine. This is something I really like touching on. People sometimes don't know that there's iodine in dairy products. There's also iodine in eggs if they are on quality pasture. If there's no iodine in the cow's diet, the milk will not have iodine. Zinc, copper, manganese, all in fairly high amounts. And then the fatty acids, conjugated linoleic acid, which has many benefits that has been shown in studies, and alpha-linolenic acid. Alpha-linolenic acid can actually be converted in a carnivore diet. The reason it can't be converted in a vegan diet is because when you consume large amounts of omega-6 fats, they compete for conversion with alpha-linolenic acid. So if you follow a carnivorous diet, a low omega-6 diet, and remove the competition of omega-6 with alpha-linolenic acid, your body can then convert some of it into EPA and DHA. Now, this is the nutrient profile for cow milk, but this also applies to goat milk. Goat milk has a very similar fat and protein content. The difference here is sheep milk. Sheep milk is 2 times fattier. As you can imagine, it's much more calorically dense. It's literally twice as many calories for 1 cup of sheep milk versus 1 cup of goat or cow's milk. This means the sheep milk can have substantially more vitamins. That being said, you could just drink more goat milk or cow milk. Essentially, if you added a cup of water to a cup of sheep milk and diluted it, that would be a similar nutrient profile to cow's milk. I mean, it would make sense to say that sheep milk is more nutrient dense per cup, but per calorie of milk, these are all relatively the same. There are composition differences that we will touch on later. So overall, if you have a high quality raw grass-fed dairy product on good pasture, you have a nutrient-dense food. The Swiss in the Llochento Valley, one of the last few civilizations to still live off of the land, actually used to light candles when the butter changed color on the summer pasture. In the fall and the winter, the butter started losing its yellow and orange color because grass contains carotenoids. When it turns to winter, the grass loses those carotenoids and the cows have to subsist off of hay. When that grass came back in the summer, these Swiss people knew the nourishing properties of the summer grasses and how it was reflected in the milk of the cow. The Swiss were a group of people who subsisted a large percent of their calories from cheese made from that summer milk, as well as rye bread. In addition to that, they still consumed meat, I would say maybe once a week, and they consumed plenty of raw milk. The Maasai consumed some milk, but if you've ever seen the Maasai, who are an African tribe known for their physical impressiveness, they are very tall, they would actually mix about 1 part milk to 4 parts blood, so they drank far more blood than dairy. And there are some northern Indian groups that did consume large amounts of dairy from butterfat, ghee, and yogurts, just a lot of dairy products in general. So the thing to keep in mind with all of these indigenous groups that consumed large amounts of dairy is that they didn't subsist solely off of dairy. They included a variety of other animal foods from really meat-based sources, not just dairy sources. So if someone wants to try to make an argument that, okay, can I subsist off of just dairy and eggs? There haven't really been any indigenous groups that have done so. And if you do analyze the nutrient profile of dairy, you can argue that there are some things that are slightly low that you might develop issues with in the long run. Hypothetically, the electrolyte ratio, it being very high in calcium. Just a couple of things to be concerned about if only consuming dairy for long periods of time. Now, how did people usually consume dairy? If kept very cold for a week to 2 weeks, it stays fresh in flavor, but it's safe to say that no group of people were ever really to refrigerate dairy. That is a modern luxury. Dairy starts to sour and ferment very quickly, dependent on the bacteria native to the environment. Granted, it's in its raw state. When you pasteurize dairy, you remove the beneficial bacteria and the enzymes that allow the food to ferment naturally. So you're removing an element of nature here that is crucial. So the dairy would sour and ferment if they weren't, you know, drinking it straight from the animal. You can also freeze dairy like butter. I don't really encourage it, and you shouldn't be freezing any non-butter dairy products for the most part. It can compromise their taste. But in regards to nutrient profile, freezing something like butter for a period of time, it still preserves the nutrients. That's not too much of an issue. But each of these groups of people had so many different methods for souring and fermenting milk. You know, the Maasai might have let it ferment in an animal's stomach that they would have carried as a bag. The Swiss made cheese. Indians have a lot of different yogurt preparations. There are so many ways to sour and ferment dairy. And this ties into the role that fermented foods play in all indigenous cultures. Every single group of our native ancestors fermented a variety of foods in a variety of ways, and dairy was included in those foods. So, we can safely say there are a lot of positives to dairy, but they can be pushed aside fairly easily if you consider some of the negatives. So, lectins aren't really the primary issue in dairy, but they contribute to a lot of issues that people have with dairy. Lectins are an anti-nutrient that's actually contained in the proteins of all foods. It's resistant to digestion. It causes leaky gut, which can lead to a system-wide immune response. So what happens here is lectins get in the small intestine because you ate the food. The lectins cause gaps in the intestinal lining, and then food can leak through. The issue here is that dairy has large fat particles and is a high saturated fat food. Saturated fat can also cause leaky gut in some people. Although lectins are something to kind of mention on the side, they are definitely something that can explain the issues that many people have with dairy. The two protein molecules are A1 casein and A2 casein. A1 casein is from Holstein cattle. It's in most dairy products in the supermarket, if not all dairy products are made from A1 casein, with the exception of some European cheeses. I've heard people mention casomorphine in dairy as a negative, but B-casomorphine 7 is only in A1 casein. And this hasn't actually been proven to be negative. There are actually some studies done that show that B-casomorphine 7 has a beneficial effect on regulating blood sugar, so that's kind of up in the air. What is safe to say is that there were randomized trials done comparing A1 casein milk to A2 casein milk, and in every single case, inflammation was lower when consuming A2 casein. So I don't know if we modified dairy products to be different. I don't know if most people come from a place where their ancestors used to consume A2 casein. It's safe to say if you're choosing between A1 and A2 casein, A2 is less inflammatory across the board. A2 coming from Guernsey, aka Jersey cattle, typically from local farms. A2 milk is becoming more popular in supermarkets lately. I mean, for me, it doesn't make a difference. I'm allergic to both. But it is interesting to note that A2 is what naturally occurs in goat and sheep dairy. The protein molecules, the casein molecules in goat and sheep, as well as most other animals, are actually the A2 casein. And not only are goat and sheep milk inherently A2, therefore less inflammatory, the fat particles in these two milks are naturally homogenized. That means that the fat particles are smaller and they are digested easier. This is different than the homogenization of the cow's milk that we see. That is unnatural and that causes issues. These small fat particles are actually beneficial because, you know, when you drink goat milk or sheep milk, it digests much quicker. Goat milk is much better than cow's milk, and I believe sheep dairy digests even quicker. I think the fat molecules in the sheep's milk are even smaller than the goat's milk. So from what I've read, it is assumed that sheep dairy is the easiest digesting form of dairy. Going from A1 to A2 casein in the context of milk that's already raw might not really fix issues for most people. In the context of supermarket dairy, it doesn't really matter because it's not something we should be consuming anyway. Histamines are the biggest issue because histamines equal allergic response. If you're allergic to dairy, you're having a histamine reaction, essentially. Histamines are immune response compounds in the body. And when we see someone with a lot of symptoms and health issues from consuming certain foods, think histamines. So you can have an allergic reaction to a food, which causes a histamine response in the body, or a food can be very high in histamine. So I could be allergic to milk and it could cause my body to produce large amounts of histamines, or I can consume cheese. And since cheese is fermented, cheese is high in histamine. Any fermented food, any aged food will be high in histamine. So as you can imagine, if you're allergic to cheese and it's high in histamine, you're pretty screwed. It's a pretty bad combination. That's why when I consume cheese, I literally have horrible cystic acne on my face, within a day or two. It's the combination of the histamine reaction from my allergy as well as the histamine content of the cheese. Histamines can bind to four different receptors. The H1 receptors can cause skin issues such as rash, skin permeability, itching, cardiovascular issues, heart palpitations, very bad. You feel like your heart's going to explode out of your chest. Stomach issues from gas, bloating to stomach pain, uterus, heavy periods, painful periods, and respiratory issues such as mucosal buildup. H2 receptors, we see the same skin, cardiovascular, and stomach issues that we see in H1 receptors, but we can also see bone marrow, which causes mast cell activation, and that's where we see very, very severe reactions that people generally need to be put in the hospital if they don't understand what's happening. H3 receptors are CNS, headache, insomnia, anxiety. It's pretty crazy when you get to this point. The H3 receptors, this is the nightmare stuff. This is where I was when I drank dairy once. I had insomnia for a week. This is nothing to think lightly of, guys. This can literally ruin your life. It's a very miserable reaction. And super, super bad. The H4 receptors also bind to bone marrow. And it could be H1 receptors one day. It could be H3 receptors the next day. You could be suffering from all of these symptoms at once if the histamines are high enough. The reason there's this pill here is because modern allergy medications are usually referred to as antihistamines, such as Benadryl. You can Google Benadryl or various antihistamine drugs and find out which receptor they bind to. So hypothetically, you could take one antihistamine for H1 and one antihistamine for H2. Now, the kicker here is a drug has never been approved for H3 or H4 histamines. That's why the skull's here. And this leads me to believe that we shouldn't be taking drugs that inhibit histamine and immune responses in the body. Long-term use of Benadryl has been shown to induce memory loss. And ever since I took large amounts of Benadryl to try to help the issues I was having with insomnia after drinking raw dairy, my memory has literally never been the same. So be very careful about using antihistamine drugs and always try to find and fix the underlying cause. This is by far one of the biggest issues with dairy that we can have. Histamine allergic reaction, not good. Can this be fixed? Hypothetically, yes. We'll touch on that in a little bit. Lactase myth. I've heard people say that raw milk contains the lactase enzyme. Therefore, if you're lactose intolerant, you can drink raw milk. Not true whatsoever. I don't know who made that up. I'm assuming someone was like, oh, well, I couldn't drink store-bought milk, and I thought I was lactose intolerant, so let me go around telling people that raw milk has the lactase enzyme. It's not true. If you're lactose intolerant, you can't drink raw milk. Think of it this way, guys. Where are all the stories? If raw milk was digestible by everyone with a lactose intolerance, I think everyone would be drinking raw milk. So lactase in raw milk is a myth. There are certain probiotic strains that are put in yogurt that do digest the lactose. So that might be where it came from. Now, lactose in the body is either digested by the lactase enzyme, you know, your body produces the lactase enzyme to digest lactose, or it's consumed by bacteria. And this can cause issues in some people because if you're lactose intolerant and you consume dairy, the gut bacteria is going to eat the lactose. This can be a good or a bad thing depending on what type of gut bacteria you have. It could be a positive for energy, or it could be something related to here, the histamines. Very bad. On to fermented dairy. The two things to keep in mind with fermented dairy are natural cultures. You know, what started the fermentation base and the source of the milk. As with what we spoke about earlier, if the milk is not nutrient dense, you're not getting nutrients anyway. So when people ask me questions like, oh, is kefir good? Is cheese good? My response is, what's the source of the dairy? Fermented dairy in particular is high in vitamin K2. When a food ferments, the vitamin K2 content rises. Vitamin K2 is kind of like the missing link in health. It's a vitamin that almost everyone is deficient in. They're injecting vitamin K into babies now. It's really unfortunate, but this is why fermented foods, or one of the reasons fermented foods played such a huge role in indigenous groups, was to obtain vitamin K2. Cheese in particular is one of the more approachable and well-known sources of vitamin K2 because K2 can only be in a food if it was on high-quality pasture. If the food was on high-quality pasture, it will have some vitamin K2 in it. Or if the food ferments, its K2 content will rise. In cheese, we really want to see only four ingredients: milk, salt, rennet, and cultures. The milk might say unpasteurized milk, it might say raw cow's milk, it might just say cow's milk, and that can still be raw. Salt is almost always added to cheese. Rennet is made in the stomach of baby cows, essentially to digest the cheese. Whether a vegetable rennet or an animal rennet is used is usually dependent on the location. A lot of European cheeses are made with animal rennet, and I haven't been able to figure out if there is a benefit to consuming animal rennet versus vegetable rennet. I'm assuming there is, as it is the more natural thing. So ideally, European cheeses made with animal rennet are what you want to look for, and the cultures are just inherent to the area that the cheese was made. Parmigiano Reggiano is made with Parmigiano Reggiano cultures. Certain bacterial cultures will develop certain flavors in the cheese. It's kind of crazy that raw cheeses are legal. You know, you can literally walk into a supermarket and buy a raw cow cheese made halfway across the world, but you can't buy raw dairy. It's interesting, but you know, it makes a food that is usually inaccessible to people accessible, and it's a great source of nutrition that, as I said, just about every single person has access to. On to the immune protocol. Some of you guys may be aware that I was testing an immune protocol for fixing a dairy allergy. It didn't really go so well. So lactose intolerance cannot be fixed. As we said earlier, your body either produces the lactase enzyme, and in some people they can't anymore, because they are lactose intolerant, or the gut bacteria will eat the lactose. So under no circumstance does this immune protocol start allowing your body to produce the lactase enzyme. I'm assuming the first people who ever consumed dairy were miserable and they were shitting their brains out. Either that or they were incredibly lucky and had dairy introduced to them as a baby, which is unlikely. I'm assuming the first people who consumed dairy in our human history were miserable, shitting their brains out every day, very sick. That's a pretty safe assumption. So hypothetically, if you were to do an immune protocol, you need to achieve several things. Eliminating the reactive immune cells. And in order to do this, you can't have any systemic inflammation. You have to be perfectly healthy. And this is the main issue here. Most people aren't perfectly healthy. Most people have some degree of systemic inflammation. So if you can't remove inflammation in the body, if you have underlying gut issues, leaky gut, whatever it may be, you can't do this protocol because it's not going to work. The thing here, guys, if you have no systemic inflammation, you're likely one of those people that can already tolerate dairy in general. So it's kind of like, all right, what's the point of this then? We need to develop anergy, which is a lack of foreign defense. That means that your body is no longer reacting to something it sees as a foreign invader, aka the milk or other dairy products. And we need to increase TREGs, which are T regulatory cells, and these cells produce immune inhibiting substances. So by consuming small amounts of a dairy product over a long period of time, hypothetically a teaspoon per day, or even smaller than that for some people a little more, you can reduce the reactive immune cells, you can create a lack of defense against these dairy particles, and through consuming other nutrients in your diet, you can increase the T regulatory cells. So basically, consume small amounts of dairy over a long period of time, and I mean incredibly small amounts of dairy. And by long period of time, we mean 4 to 6 weeks, maybe 2 months. And you need to have the other vitamins present in your diet. You need to have adequate vitamin A, vitamin D, vitamin K, omega fatty acids. You need to have every nutrient in your diet and make sure your body is functioning properly in order to achieve this. So hypothetically, on paper, it's possible to fix an allergy. I've never seen anyone do it. I haven't been able to do it myself. So who knows? Maybe I'll revisit it in 6 months, a year from now, and try it again. But there's other issues at play here. Candida equals dysbiosis. Or dysbiosis equals candida. It can be the other way around too. So dysbiosis is an imbalance of gut bacteria. And it's very easy to imbalance gut bacteria with a high fat and sugar consumption. Milk is high in fat and sugar. If you have underlying issues, you can very easily cause candida by consuming raw milk. I don't know if this is a problem unique to me. If any other people have experience with this, I would love to hear it. I drank raw milk. I got very horrible candida and gut dysbiosis. And that can be attributed to the saturated fat availability. Some people don't tolerate easily available saturated fat well. What I mean by this is the saturated fat in dairy products, particularly milk or butter, digests much quicker than other fat product, you know, like raw fat from an animal. So the combination of highly available fat and highly available milk sugar to the gut bacteria pretty much let it go wild. You know, instead of my stomach absorbing the fat and the lactose, the gut bacteria was eating it and that caused issues. So there's a lot of underlying problems that can happen when you try something like this if you're not meant to consume it. I'll revisit it, as I said, guys, in 6 months to a year, but my experiment did not go well. I was suffering from a lot of histamine reactions. You know, I was getting insomnia, anxiety. My heart palpitations were coming back. I've tried colostrum, and colostrum is from the first milking of the cow. It has special immunoglobulins, which increase the immune strength of the person hypothetically. I didn't notice any benefits from consuming colostrum. I don't really know if it can actually translate to increasing the immune system function in humans, especially if you are allergic to it. So what I pretty much did was consumed equal parts colostrum and raw milk for a period of about 2 months in very small amounts, and it didn't work. So that's my experience with that, guys. You can try it on your own. Let me know if you have a story, if it worked for you. But as you can tell by my tone of voice, I am not too optimistic about it. Here we have, who drew that block of cheese? He must be cute and talented. So if you guys have ever seen a wheel of Parmigiano Reggiano, it has, you know, these specific, you know, writing, like the dots and stuff on the rind. It looks pretty cool. But what this means is it's from the Parmigiano Reggiano DOP, which is a designation of protection. It means the milk was made in a certain way, from certain quality cows in a certain time of the year, blah, blah, blah. This is pretty much assurance that it's a high quality raw cow's milk cheese. And there's a ton of other DOPs, designation of protections for various cheeses, that you guys can become aware of to know, you know, where can you source quality food. Down here, I just have some words that I thought of with dairy. So we have ghee, which is clarified butter, very popular in Indian cooking. They just take the butter, they heat it. What happens is the milk protein separates, and then you have this pure butter fat. Some people who are allergic to certain dairy can tolerate ghee. I am allergic to ghee as well. You would think that once you remove the casein protein, blah, blah, blah. No, I'm still allergic to the butter fat. Milk sugar. Can lactose cause an issue? Can the milk sugar be an issue for people on a zero-carb carnivore diet? I wouldn't really look at lactose and the sugar and the carbohydrate content of milk. I would consume the product and see how you tolerate it. Looking at macronutrients doesn't solve problems for anyone. Acne, huge issue with dairy. I always get acne within a day or two after consuming dairy. It's a telltale sign of, you know, leaky gut, dairy-related issues. And it's really crazy how dairy might actually be the food that's most strongly correlated with acne. Same thing with gas. If you consume dairy, you start having a lot of flatulence, indicator that you shouldn't be eating it. On the other hand, dairy was actually fed to nursing and pregnant women in certain indigenous tribes for fertility. Just as fish, eggs, or liver might be viewed as a nutrient-dense food, a lot of these tribes and groups of indigenous people viewed dairy that was grown on spring and summer grass as a fertility food. And pasteurized, as we spoke about, that type of dairy shouldn't really be consumed. I know a lot of you guys are fans of Kerrygold butter. You know, Kerrygold's written down here. You know, Kerrygold might taste a little better, but it's still not a great option for nutrition. Kefir. A lot of you guys ask me about kefir. I actually did make my own kefir culture successfully. You pretty much just put a jar of milk out by a windowsill for a couple days, and that starts the natural fermentation process. So, you guys are asking me about kefir grains. As I spoke about earlier, natural cultures to me are important. If I can make kefir grains or a starter culture from my natural native environment, I would much rather do that than to buy kefir grains from somewhere else. And if you don't tolerate milk, you might be able to tolerate kefir better. But there's definitely something to be said that if you don't tolerate certain dairy products, it's safe to say that when you eat ones that you think you can tolerate, you're probably just missing the reactions. They're probably going under the radar or you don't notice them too much. So I would say if you think you tolerate certain dairy products where you can't tolerate others, I would just remove them from your diet for a fairly long period of time, then reintroduce them to gauge your reaction. The Sardinians in Italy actually consumed a fairly high percentage of their animal-based calories from raw goat milk, raw sheep milk. And they're a centenarian group. They commonly live to over 100. Something important to be said about food quality and how nutrient density, the vitamin content, really ties into overall human health. Just a few final things to touch on. As I said, guys, I do have those comparison videos, the dairy comparison last week and the grain-fed, grass-fed beef comparison several weeks ago. I do have a video on bacteria that I will link at the end here, where I go further into various issues that can come up with consuming raw foods. Realmilk.com is a place where you can find local raw grass-fed dairy. I recently launched Frankie's Free Range Meat. We do sell raw cheese at frankiesfreerangemeat.com. We will definitely be selling raw dairy in the future. It's just dependent on the support we receive from people because we need to own the farm. Raw dairy has to be shipped directly from the farm to the consumer. So if you guys are looking forward to consuming raw milk, raw butter, raw cream, and you can't find it locally near you, maybe that's something to look forward to in the future of Frankie's Free Range Meat, providing you guys with a variety of raw dairy products. Immediately right now, we do have raw cheeses, such as Parmigiano Reggiano. Some of the more famous raw cheeses there are. We have some English cheddars, Gouda cheese, as well as Gruyere cheese. The cheeses on our website are not only raw and incredibly high quality, they are some of the best tasting and most famous cheeses in the world. So guys, definitely check out frankiesfreerangemeat.com if you want to support that vision or just check out what we have and maybe what's in store for the future. I'll touch briefly on pricing. What I've noticed is raw dairy in Europe is substantially cheaper. In the United States, a gallon of cow's milk is generally between $9 and $12 a gallon. Raw butter can be anywhere from like $11 to $16 a pound. Some of these raw dairy products can get very expensive. If you look at goat's milk, I've seen goat's milk as cheap as like $12 to $13 a gallon. Other times it can go up to like $25. Sheep milk is incredibly expensive. Sheep milk is usually around $30 to $40 a gallon because of how little milk the sheep produce. But pricing wise, you want to spend your money on a product that's actually good for you. So if you're going to invest some money, you know, a gallon of cow, goat, or sheep milk isn't really too unaffordable from a caloric perspective. I mean, of course, cheeses tend to always be on the expensive side. Unfortunately, some of these raw milk companies gouge the hell out of people because they know there's a demand and they're the only supplier. So another one of our goals in the future with Frankie's Free Range Meat is not to rip people off, essentially. It's something I've dealt with, and although I don't consume raw dairy myself, I do purchase a lot of it for my family, so I know how much it hurts the wallet. Outside of that, thank you guys for watching. Please like, subscribe, hit that bell icon. It's right next to the subscribe button, and share the video if you can. Big shout out to Adam from Grithin.com. That's Grithin. He helped me a bit with the allergy protocol as well as several concepts mentioned in this video. If you guys would like to support the channel further, check out some of the other videos that I'm going to link at the end here. And as I mentioned earlier, if you want to learn more about Frankie's Free Range Meat, go to frankiesfreerangemeat.com to read more. Thanks again, guys, and enjoy the rest of the week.